Welcome to worship. We're glad that you could join us today. Please remember that during this service, there will be an opportunity to have communion at home. So we invite you now to get some bread, get some wine, grape juice, have that set up and ready for the time of communion. Also, our text, focus text for worship this week is Acts chapter 6. So if you have your Bible there, you can open it up to Acts chapter 6 and get ready for that. Also, make sure that you click on the connect card and give us your information. It's important to us to be able to connect with you and to know who it is that's tuning in to participate in our worship. And as always, when you are here at Abiding Hope, whether in person or through digital means, you're at home because we are all family. So, welcome home. Resurrection, that on that Sunday morning, all things were made new through the risen Christ. And when God sends the Holy Spirit into our lives, it's not to keep us where we are. It's not to maintain the status quo. It's not to keep us in our old patterns and old traditions. It's to draw us into something new. God is alive in us, and we are called to be open to the work of the Spirit to actively participate in this new thing that God is wanting to do in our lives and in the world.
We can feel the rising of the sun.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Loving God, this time, this place, this situation we're in is new territory for all of us. We've never walked this part of the path before. We've never experienced these challenges in the course of our journey. And so we struggle to find direction. We struggle to find what it is that you're truly calling us to be and to do. And so open us, Lord. Open us to the voice of your Spirit. Open us to be able to be aware of your presence in our lives. Open us to hear how it is that you're calling us to be the heart, hands, and feet of Jesus in this world. As the early church had to deal with bringing Jews and Gentiles together, creating a new culture, not just taking the old, but creating a new culture of these blended peoples, we feel like we're in the same situation. And so help us to learn from the work of Peter and Stephen, of Paul, those who were involved in creating that new Jesus community, so that we can be cultural architects today who create ways of life and opportunities for all to truly live as children of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now, kiddos, we invite you to come on down close to the screen for your time with Pastor Jay.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to our children's message. And I'm going to start by saying what's happening. And you all are going to say we are. Y'all ready? What's happening?
We are.
Yeah, you are. What's happening? So, hey, I want to know, what do you want to be when you grow up? Nathaniel, what do you want to be when you grow up?
A Lego builder.
That's a good one. Hudson, what do you want to be when you grow up? Oh, what was that?
Lion.
Oh, a lion. I love that. Charlotte, what do you want to be when you grow up?
I want to be an underwater photographer.
Oh, that's really cool. Eden, what do you want to be when you grow up?
I don't really know yet.
You don't really know yet. You know what I used to say that I wanted to be when I grew up? I wanted to be a taxi cab driver. Because I thought you did the two coolest things as a taxi cab driver. You got to drive a car and you got to handle money. And I thought that those were the two coolest things. But you know what? Today in our gospel text, there's a guy named Stephen who, it turns out there's a bunch of people who needed help. And it said that he's full of the Spirit. He's full of love. And so he was chosen to help them out. And so you know what that got me thinking about? When somebody asks you what you want to be when you grow up, the first thing we think about is what? A job. Yeah, like your work, right? But when we really think about what we want to be, what do you really want to be when you grow up? So let me give you a hint. When I was thinking about this, I was thinking, what I want to be when I grow up is I want to be kind. One of the things I want to be when I grow up is kind. So
you already are grown up.
Charlotte, what'd you say?
You already grown up.
I can't hear you. I'm sorry, honey.
Never mind.
And Nathaniel.
You are grown up.
So if you think, well, I'm sort of grown up. I'm still growing up, I think. Hey, Charlotte, so what is something you want to be when you grow up? Not your job, but what is something you want to be?
I want to be a better animal carrier.
Okay, so you want to be compassionate about animals. I love that idea. Nathaniel, I want to be kind. What do you want to be when you grow up?
I don't know.
That's all right. Eden, what's something you want to be when you grow up? Do you want to be helpful, or do you want to be a servant, or you want to be kind, or you want to be loving? What's something you want to be when you grow up?
I want to be helpful.
Yeah. So, you know, when we're thinking about this week about what we're going to be, maybe next time somebody asks you, hey, what do you want to be when you grow up? Maybe you can respond, I want to be helpful, or I want to be compassionate, or I want to be kind. Hey, Hudson, real quick, what do you want to be when you grow up? What do you think, Hudson?
Like a Lion.
Oh, I like that. Still being like a lion. That's also a great thing to be. So while you guys are, next time somebody asks you what you want to be, think about what you really want to be when you grow up, all right? Hey, let's all pray together, hands out wide, ready? Let us pray. Dear God. Thank you for making us.
Thank you for making us.
Help us to become what you want us to be. In your name we pray.
In your name we pray.
Amen. Awesome. Hey, thanks guys for being a part of our children's message. I'll see you guys later. Bye.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King of all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would make a way for us to rise above. You would lay down your love that we would be set free. Jesus, we sing for all that you've done.
Disciples were increasing in number, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food. The 12 called together the whole community of disciples and said, "It is not right that we should neglect the word of God in order to wait at tables. Therefore, friends, selected from among yourselves 7 men to appoint to this task, while we, for our part, will devote ourselves to the prayer and to serving the word. What they said pleased the whole community. They chose Stephen, a man of full faith and the Holy Spirit, together with Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicolaus, a proselyte of Antioch. They had these men stand before the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. The word of God continued to spread. The number of disciples increased greatly in Jerusalem, and the great many of the priests became obedient in faith, Here is the reading. May the seed of God's word take root and bear fruit in our lives.
I'm here in front of the hospital thinking about the ways in which so many people have been serving the communities in which people live. It's been really interesting to watch the response that people have had to the ways in which especially our healthcare workers have jumped into the fray and are helping in ways that put them at risk. When we especially look at different places like in New York and beyond, we see how these hospitals have been full of people, that they're just packed full of people that are sick with COVID, and that we see, and we've heard these stories of these healthcare workers who are living in their trailers and in RVs out in their front yard to simply be able to continue to help. They've been separated from their own family by yards for months. I've heard stories of healthcare workers who've contracted COVID, even some in New York who have died from COVID. And when I think about these people, I begin to think about that central question of occupation and vocation. When I think about occupation, I think about the actual jobs in which they're called to do. I'm thinking about the work in which they've been up to. Nurses and staff and technicians, doctors and surgeons and all of the different ways in which different healthcare workers have made a livelihood. But that's different from that sense of vocation. Vocation is that where we get that word voca, vocal. It's our calling. It's that part of us that feels that deep groaning inside us that wants to meet the deep groaning of the world, as Walter Brueggemann once said. When I think about these healthcare workers and the way that they've been serving, it's not because they have a job in that. It's not because they have an occupation. It's because they have a calling to help. They have a calling to serve. And when people are sick, that's when they feel most alive in their call. See, it's not about occupation, it's about vocation. And the way in which they're serving is about the way in which they're living out their calling. In our text today, we have this seemingly innocuous story. It seems almost like a detail added to the story of the disciples that is almost kind of, you wonder what's the point? It begins simply that there is, in the earliest story of the church, that the way in which they lived were out of these agape feasts, that the people of God would gather together for these meals and they would live and serve together. Now, as more Greeks, what they would call Hellenists, became a part of the community, it seems that there was a little division between the Hebrew people and the Hellenists. Perhaps the Hebrew people were still trapped in that understanding of food laws and worried about the ways in which food laws might affect them. And there's still some divisions between the Hellenists and the Hebrews. Perhaps. More on that in a couple of weeks. But what's interesting is that the community is beginning to blend together. They're finding ways in which to live together as one people. That they're not excluding Hellenists. In fact, they bring the Hellenists, the Greeks, bring their concerns to the disciples and say, we have a problem. Some people are eating and some people are not at our meals. It seems like our widows, our women, are being neglected. Now, the Hebrew people might defend themselves and say, well, according to the law, you're unclean and maybe we're not allowed to be near you or around you. But instead, they find another way to do this. They immediately see that there's a need that needs to be addressed. And so the disciples say, we really can't spend more of our time. Our calling, our vocation is not to serve in terms of meals and food. Our calling is to serve the word of God, to be teachers and leaders. So the first thing that is identified is that the apostles, the disciples, and the leaders around that time are identifying their own vocation to be the preachers of the word, the leaders of the community. And as leaders, then they say, now we need to identify people that have a different kind of vocation. We need to identify people that have a different kind of calling. And so they say to the Greeks, they say, find people with you, people full of spirit and truth, people full of love, and ask them to come help you. So they appoint among the Hellenists more people to lead and guide. And so they do. They appoint initially this leader among the Greeks named Stephen. And Stephen becomes a key leader in that early church. It's for this reason that we at Abiding Hope have started a ministry called Stephen Ministry. In Stephen Ministry, we train people for weeks, even months, on how to sit beside, lead, and guide people that are in need. Stephen ministers work very hard at holding one another accountable, training one another to be accountable, so that the care they give is healthy and whole, and that it comes from a space of the other person's need as opposed to their own. To be a Stephen minister requires a calling, a vocation. When I think of my own calling, and I think of my life as a pastor, I really do have to think about the difference between vocation and occupation. Yeah, my job is as a pastor, and with that role of pastor comes the duties and responsibilities that we expect of a lot of pastors. We expect to be visited and worship to be led and the people to be cared for. Another big part of my call when I took on this role of pastor, there's an airplane going overhead, you probably can hear that. Another part of my role as being a pastor is speaking on behalf of the poor and the oppressed, and the needy and the hurt. When I made my vow as a pastor, that was a part of my call. My call isn't so much to be pastor in terms of an occupation. My call is to be pastor in terms of what the word pastor means. The word pastor comes from that word for shepherd. I'm called to be a leader. I'm called to see people transformed, to see them become someone and something different than what they were before. And for me, that means people like you and I, members at Abiding Hope, to see our lives called and transformed, to see people see the world in a new way. My call is to see you transformed in the way that you're caring and loving other people in the community, to help you discover your purpose, to help you discover meaning in your life, far beyond your job, but to see true life come alive in you as you discover God's vision for the world and as you strive for that vision of the world, a world and a vision which may not be what you're used to hearing and seeing, that transformation that sometimes is painful. I'm called to speak on behalf of those who may not have a voice themselves. I'm called to see a transformation in the world. I'm called to see things change and not to prop things up the way they've always been. If there's anything that Luther taught us in this time of the church, it's a sense of vocation, of discovering where we're being called as the church. As Stephen heeded the call to help and serve the widows in his community, we have to be listening and hearing to the call that we're called to be as the church. Our job is not always to be the same. As Luther says, we're called to be always reforming. Semper reformanda, that means always changing, always seeking, always discovering where the Spirit is leading us. You see, when they asked for the Greeks to pick men among them, and at this point, the people listed were men, but women were a part of this as well. They said to find people who are full of Spirit, who are full of love, who are full of that sense of where God is leading them and calling them to be. I want to be one of those people full of Spirit. And I want to find other people full of Spirit around me, called to the same kind of transformation I'm being called to. When I say catch the Spirit, when we think of that theme for our vision right now of catching the Spirit, it's catching that vision, catching that sense, catching that desire to be transformed into the way and into the life of God. In Christ, we saw a true transformation, that the way the world had been was being transformed into a new way. The ways of glory, the ways of victory, the ways of power were being transformed and turned upside down. Because in Christ, we no longer saw the most powerful as being the ones to follow. But Jesus says, if you want to lead, you have to become a servant. So my question for you all today is this. Like Stephen, where are you being called to serve? Where is your vocation? I pray that your vocation and your occupation align, but if they don't, it doesn't mean find a new vocation, but to find those areas in which your vocation can come through. And that voice, that call in which you're feeling, whose voice is that? Is this the voice of Christ beckoning you into a new way of being in the world? Is it a new voice asking you to be in semper reformanda, always in the act of transforming, just like that first community was transforming? Are you ready to be changed in the way that God wants you to be changed? My prayer for each of us is that when we're answering that call of what we are to be, it's not our occupation, but it's that sense of who God is calling us to be in the world. We're called to be like little Christs, laying down our life for the other, crucified as Christ was, resurrected as Christ was, so that we can be the change agents in the world, the reformanda in the world, so that all may experience that real life. May you on this day hear the voice of God calling you and catch that spirit and come alive in a true and real transformation. If you'll pray with me. Holy God, your spirit is beckoning us and always calling us into a new way of being in the world. Be with us again this day, God. May your spirit visit our hearts, transforming us ever more into your likeness. May we hear your call and go where you send us, becoming your servants. We pray all these things in the name of love, whose name is Jesus. Amen.
Trusting in God's promise of new life, we join the people of God in this time and in all places in praying for the renewal of the world, the church, and all of creation. Companion God, you journey with your people through every season of life. Grant grace and strength to those you call to help and support your people. Thank you for Stephen ministers who are called to be your servants. We also give thanks for first responders, doctors, nurses, staff, and all those who place themselves at risk to bring life and health. O God, with hurting hearts we pray, spark new life in us today. Mothering God, you are strong beyond all reckoning. May your courage flow through us, that we may have the ability to help others when we are afraid, to speak up for others when we are at risk, and love others when we feel ourselves unlovable. O God, with hurting hearts we pray, spark new life in us today. God of life, in you we find wholeness. Bring to us the fullness of your love, especially to those who are burdened with pain of sickness and disease, discrimination and loneliness, fear and anxiety. Send your spirit to all who cry out to you. O God, with hurting hearts we pray, spark new life in us today. You remind us we too will live as Jesus lives. Be with the families and friends who mourn. Give them hope. O God, with hurting hearts we pray, spark new life in us today. And now, as we prepare our hearts to worship you with the act of offering, we pray together. O God, you create in us a new spirit, inspiring us to stretch our limits and reframe our perspectives so all may be rebirthed into new life. Increase our trust in you so that we may catch your spirit and live into a renewed passion with generous and loving hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our core values at Abiding Hope are authentic worship, intentional relationships, sacrificial service, and radical generosity. When we put those values together, the term radical was chosen because it means rooted. Rooted. We are called to live generous lives that root us in Christ, that form and shape us to be the vessels, the heart, hands, and feet of Jesus in this world. And our generosity is intended to root others in Christ, to be a blessing in their lives. And so now this is the time of worship when we challenge you to be generous. So we hope that you'll go to our website or that you'll click on Give and that you'll give your generous gift so that you and others are rooted in Christ.
From our fears.
peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We invite you to take out your phone, send somebody a text message, and just say, peace be with you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You know, there's nothing better in this world than drawing people together around a meal, around food. It's hard to eat with your enemies. It's hard to eat with people that you're mad at. And so Jesus understood that when we gather around a table and we share this feast, not just any feast, but a feast of God's vision of oneness for the world, that something happens in us, that we're changed, transformed, we're made new. And so it makes no sense to exclude people from this table. It makes no sense to say to some, you're welcome, but to others, you're not. And so here at Abiding Hope, anytime we have this feast, whoever's present is welcome and invited to participate. Because we know that no matter how much division exists in the world, here in God's reign, the gifts of God are
free.
We invite you now to share Holy Communion with those who are with you. And if you're by yourself, hear the words, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you.
There will be no more sorrow.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen. Amen.
God's Spirit is stirring in us and leading us to something new. Rise up, catch the Spirit, and be amazed by the boundless opportunities to experience real life. Love God, serve God.
Love all, serve all.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.